I'd like to welcome everybody this evening to tonight's Thorium debate. My name is Tim. I'm going to be one of the participants in the debate. But right now I'm going to be serving as a brief moderator until Andy is done collecting. My opponent tonight is Dennis Nelson. We're going to be debating our energy future. I'm going to be advocating nuclear power, specifically thorium molten salt reactors. And Dennis Nelson's going to be advocating the all renewable way of doing things. I think it's going to be a good, lively debate, and we should have a very good and open time. There are two rules at the College of Complexes. One is one fool at a time. The second one is no personal attacks. No, I hope that, I know, Charlie.
Yeah, tonight.
Well, we expect some juvenile behavior from some of our compatriots here at the college. But that's quite a bit. The format of the college consists of the following. First, we have announcements. Second, we have our debate, which is going to consist of three rounds. One round of 10 minutes each, a second round of 10 minutes each, and then a third round of 5 minutes each for concluding remarks. Then we will go to questions and answers. Then we will go to our infamous rebuttal period. And then me and Dennis will close out the night, dividing the time equally amongst us for concluding remarks. With, as everything else, yes?
If you can have a molten thorium salt reactor, would you have a molten sugar thorium reactor?
molten sugar reactors. Ooh, what a concept. Ready? Let's flip a coin and see who goes first. I'd like to welcome Dennis Nelson and myself, Tim Bolger, for a rousing round of thorium debates for our energy future. Okay, I do not have a coin here. Okay, so we're going to do the coin toss for who goes first.
And we're doing this in front of everybody so that there's no, like,
double-headed coin.
Yeah, but we have complete transparency here tonight.
Yes.
At least for...
Heads I win, tails you lose.
Oh, that's right.
I'm kidding. And there's... I'd also like to welcome our camera guy, Paul, has come here tonight, too. And so he's all good to go. Dennis, when you're ready with the coin,
okay.
Do you want me to flip or do you want to
go to flip?
Okay, I'll flip and you'll call it.
I'll call heads.
All right.
Call heads.
All right, and the coin reads
heads.
Heads. Do you elect to receive or?
I'm sorry.
Do you want to go first or second, Dennis?
We'll go first.
Okay, Dennis Nelson is first. I will rebut him in 10 minutes. We may need a little, you got a timer, Andy? Okay.
10 and 10,
and then two final rounds of five.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
My name is Dennis Nelson. I'm with the Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS. The title for my debate presentation is Non-Nuclear Energy Pathways to Increase Our Prosperity, Eliminate All Fossil Fuels, and Promote Climate Protection. Part A, please dismiss the pro-nuclear thorium hype. A nuclear thorium future will make our world a lot worse place to live. I oppose all commercial nuclear fuel cycles because of their wide range of technical and non-technical liabilities. Tim Bolger of the Thorium Energy Alliance has directly ignored the questions in my previous presentations about the harassment and intimidation of nuclear whistleblowers, the threats to our civil liberties and freedoms, and pro-nuclear hanky-panky nuclear deception that has suppressed, manipulated, and distorted information. On December 17th of last year, Tim asked me why he looks at the same data and reaches a different conclusion. but the question of whether we should go nuclear or even have any nuclear at all goes beyond physics, chemistry, engineering, and even radiation biology and radio ecology. I have encouraged people to learn as much as possible about the scientific and technical aspects of nuclear power, but the far more important public policy questions deal with societal impacts, social, political, economic, environmental, and moral ethical. Developing and constructing a commercial liquid molten salt thorium reactor and the entire thorium fuel cycle infrastructure that must accompany it is a nuclear technical fix. It will leave my non-technical issues unresolved. In fact, I bet they'll be perpetuated. I disagree with Tim's carefully crafted pro-nuclear thorium bubble position. I have a 161-page report from the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, USNRC, which is entitled Safety and Regulatory Issues of the Thorium Fuel Cycle, February 2014. There are different reactor uses listed for thorium in commercial nuclear fuel cycles. One of the primary objectives of the report is to identify the key knowledge gaps and technical issues that need to be addressed in the licensing of thorium fuel for our current light water uranium reactors. Believe me, there are plenty of both. The thorium molten salt reactor is acknowledged in this report as being in the research and development experimental stage in China. As I have said in my other two presentations about this subject, there is no licensed commercial thorium molten salt reactor in existence. Of course, Tim's preferred use is this liquid molten salt thorium reactor, but the others cannot be ignored. Tim is extremely selective in his arguments in promoting his favorite reactor design. NEIS condemns the thorium fuel cycle in any form. Let's hear from physicist and energy consultant Amory B. Lovins, co-founder and chief scientist, Rocky Mountain Institute. Quote, some enthusiasts prefer fueling reactors with thorium, an element three times as abundant as uranium, but even more uneconomic to use. India has for decades failed to commercialize breeder reactors to exploit its thorium deposits. But thorium can't fuel a reactor by itself. Rather, a uranium or plutonium-fueled reactor will convert thorium-232 into fissionable and plutonium-like, highly bomb-usable uranium-233. Thorium's proliferation, waste, safety, and cost problems differ only in detail from uranium's, e.g., thorium ore makes less mill waste, but highly radioactive U-232 makes fabricating or reprocessing U-233 fuel hard and costly. And with uranium-based nuclear power continuing its decade-long economic collapse, it's all too late to be thinking of developing a whole new fuel cycle whose problems differ only in detail from current versions, unquote. We come to the mystery of the missing uranium-233 that was produced from thorium-232. Over about 50 years, our government has wasted billions of dollars in the vain and fruitless struggle to develop nuclear thorium. Also, our government will have to spend billions more to deal with the radioactive waste created by those failed efforts at numerous federal nuclear sites. The U.S. Department of Energy, US DOE, seems to have lost track of 96 kilograms, or 6% of uranium-233, mainly from its weapons production reactors at Oak Ridge and Idaho National Laboratories. This uranium-233 is fissionable material made from thorium-232 and is enough to make at least a dozen nuclear weapons. For a nuclear terrorist, uranium-233 is a tempting theft target. It requires no advanced shaping and implosion technology to be fashioned into a workable nuclear bomb. As for the ionizing radiation levels from uranium-232, a highly radioactive contaminant co-produced with uranium-233, researchers from Oak Ridge National Laboratory have noted that, quote, if a diverter was motivated by foreign nationalistic purposes, personnel exposure would be of no concern since exposure would not result in immediate death, unquote. The U.S. DOE is battling the state of Nevada over the proposed dumping of almost 1 ton of leftover diluted uranium-233 made from thorium-232 in a government landfill, which would violate international standards. So we have thorium, the so-called superfuel that never was, isn't now, and never will be. Irradiated spent reactor fuel is a high-level radioactive waste. According to Fairwinds Energy Education, the Institute for Energy and Environmental Research, and Physicians for Social Responsibility, quote, if the spent fuel is not reprocessed, thorium-232 is very long-lived, half-life 14 billion years, and its decay products will build up over time in the spent fuel. This will make the spent fuel quite radiotoxic. In addition to all the fission products in it, it should also be noted that inhalation of a unit of radioactivity of thorium-232 or thorium-228, which is also present as a decay product of thorium-232, produces a far higher dose, particularly to certain organs, than the inhalation of uranium containing the same amount of radioactivity. For instance, the bone surface dose from breathing an amount mass of insoluble thorium is about 200 times that of breathing the same mass of uranium, unquote. The reprocessing of irradiated reactor fuel makes no economic sense. Reprocessing also increases the risk of ionizing radiation exposure through transportation and the separation process itself. The longer-term high-level radioactive waste management problem would still remain. The pro-nuclear thorium cheerleaders still claim that a thorium reactor is nearer to closing the nuclear fuel cycle with the reprocessing of irradiated reactor fuel. But according to Arne Gunderson, a former nuclear engineer, and now a carbon-free, nuclear-free proponent with Fairwinds Energy Education, quote, the French and actually the Japanese bought into this. No one has really what we call closed the nuclear fuel cycle. The Japanese tried for years and spent trillions of yen or hundreds of billions of dollars in trying to reprocess fuel and failed every time. My point is that if we had spent that money on alternative energy sources, we would be much more likely to have a solution right at hand that is really cheap, and instead we put all our money on the wrong horse in this race, unquote. Even the US DOE's Idaho National Laboratory puts thorium reactors in the same category as all other nuclear reactors. Quote, the choice between uranium-based fuel and thorium-based fuel is seen basically as one of preference, but no fundamental difference in addressing the nuclear power issues of waste management, proliferation risk, safety, security, economics, and sustainability. Since no infrastructure currently exists in the U.S. for thorium-based fuels, and the processing of thorium-based fuels is at a lower level of technical maturity when compared to processing of uranium-based fuels, costs and RD&D, research, development, and deployment requirements for using thorium are anticipated to be higher, unquote. Roger Sewell, a California attorney who has an engineering background, concludes that the greatest engineering problem with the liquid molten salt thorium reactor is likely to be the scale up by a factor of 500 to 1 from the smaller experimental project with only 7.4 megawatts thermal output at Oak Ridge National Laboratory to a full-scale commercial plant of 3,500 megawatts thermal output. Perhaps these technical problems can be overcome, but why would anybody bother to try, knowing in advance that the molten salt thorium reactor will be uneconomic due to huge construction operating costs? Also, higher pressurized water will inevitably leak from the steam generator tubes into the lower pressurized hot radioactive molten salt and will explosively turn to steam. There are serious reasons why the U.S. has not pursued development of the molten salt thorium process. However, China has started a development program for this using technical information and assistance from Oak Ridge National Laboratory. Quote, one hopes that stout umbrellas can be issued to the Chinese population that will withstand the raining down of molten radioactive fluoride salt when one of the reactors explodes, unquote. Again, we are talking about a severe steam explosion, not a nuclear explosion. Thank you. That ends part A.
That's a hard one to follow, but I'm going to show you a little bit. First off, I'm going to define the need for nuclear power, and the second thing is I'm going to tell you exactly what a molten salt thorium reactor is, because what Dennis has basically done was also help me promote my thing by saying exactly what it is. Now, If you'll excuse me, I'm going to get a quick video up and we'll be ready to roll in a second here.
No, Tim, I didn't have a well.
There's no such thing as a reaction.
Oh, boy.
Doesn't exist. Like, don't exist.
I'm all about the meter.
Except the little toy one.
No, no, I'm one of these. I'll fix them. Don't you do it.
We're going to first run a quick video on why we, if the computer works here, we'll be all set. Hang on. Be ready.
No problem with technology.
Yeah, I know, no problem with technology, Joe, but we got it.
It's like the reactor.
What?
They'll be working in a minute. You got Richard Nixon? He likes him.
The old oil. 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 The old oil.
Yeah. Our imports of foreign oil have been climbing steadily since 1985 and now stand at 42% of our total consumption.
We need a long-term energy strategy to maximize conservation and maximize the development of alternative sources of energy.
America is addicted to oil, often imported from unstable parts of the world. This country can dramatically improve our environment, move beyond a petroleum-based economy, and make our dependence on Middle Eastern oil a thing of the past.
In 10 years, we will finally end our dependence on oil from the Middle East.
Anyway, what we're trying to establish here is the simple fact that we're going to have to get off oil. The second thing is that the world is going to need about five times as much more power as we're dealing with today. Human beings want electric power for better lives, for a better way of life, for development, and the fastest and quickest way to that is through cheap power. If we don't have nuclear as part of the energy mix, including solar and wind, I would say you're crazy, because even though Dennis did point out the shortcomings of the present form of nuclear power in the form of the light water reactor, it does and still continues to support about 20% of our electrical production, and most of the reactors were built in less than 25 years, providing much more power, much more compatibility to the grid. Now, I'm not going to downplay the issues with nuclear waste, but in dealing with it, it's certainly a lot less than what we would have if we had if we had thrown carbon into the atmosphere, if we had done things, and let's face it, if we don't have renewables, if the sun don't shine, if the power don't go up, you're going to be using natural gas. Yeah, go ahead, Eddie.
A little bit farther from the mic.
All right. You'll be using natural gas, or you'll be using some form of fossil fuels, or you'll be using coal like the rest of the world does today. And coal is cheap. Now, what I found out through the implementation of molten salt reactor technology is that it can and does provide a viable alternative. Once you basically learn what a molten salt reactor is, I've got another quick video here that's about 3 minutes from a seventh grader explaining exactly what it is. Her name is Katie Hudak. She explained this at a Thorium Energy Alliance conference not too long ago. Basically what she did was, I'm going to have to advance it here a little bit. What she did was basically, huh? She's in high school now, but here it is. I can get it. Yeah, well.
Perfect for the college.
Yeah, perfect for the college. I'm having all my technology go on me. There's another one I got here too.
Meltdown.
Yeah, it's a meltdown. We'll try this one.
Well,
one thing for sure, we we humans, we need electricity now. But since fossil fuels are turning our environment into a crop circus, scientists are telling us not to discount nuclear energy. In fact, they say that maybe we should switch our uranium-based nuclear reactors to safer, cheaper thorium-based ones. Thorium is an element in metal that's close to uranium on the periodic table of two fewer protons. And it's named after Thor, the Norse god of thunder, which is cool, but it's not an element that we've historically paid much attention to, seeing as pretty much dirt. In fact, till recently, most mining operations literally blew it out while they were trying to get other stuff. But a small and growing group of thorium fans say that it is the future of power production. People are pushing the idea of adapting existing nuclear power plants to use thorium fuel or replacing them entirely with a completely new kind of reactor called liquid fluoride thorium.
Can you guys hear this?
Louder.
Lifter uses a mixture of liquid salt to cool the reactor and to transfer the heat energy out of the fission chamber into something that can then power a turbine. Proponents say that such a system would be more efficient and safer than the pressurized water used to cool uranium fuel rod now. The boiling water and steam used to transfer the energy. Because Lifter doesn't use water for cooling, there's no possibility of a hydrogen explosion like what happened in Fukushima. Also, although thorium is a radioactive element, it emits alpha particles, which are less biologically harmful than uranium gamma particles. Thorium fuel reactors use a fraction of the material necessary to run a uranium-based reactor, and they produce waste that's toxic for a shorter amount of time, 300 years compared to uranium's 10,000. And unlike uranium, it's very difficult to turn it into a weapon. So, why haven't we started building these things? Like yesterday. Well, we almost did. In the 1950s, there was essentially a competition between uranium and thorium-based systems. It was determined that uranium used in a light water reactor was the quickest, easiest way to power a nuclear submarine. And as a bonus, waste from the process could be used to make bombs. So Washington was like, yay, uranium, while thorium-based plant at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory conceived its mothballs. Today, the biggest problem with converting to thorium reactors is expense. The reactors themselves aren't that expensive to use the thorium. The trouble is, all of America's 104 nuclear power plants currently run on uranium, and a lot of people doubt whether going to be expensive pressure with the nuclear plant is worth it, since they would still produce waste is not as much. In the meantime, you will be unsurprised to find that China is taking the lead on developing Lifter. So I guess maybe we should just see how that goes for them. What do you think? Thank you for watching this episode of SciShow. If you have any questions, please comment or ideas, please leave them down in the comments below or get to us on Facebook or Twitter. We'll see you next time.
All right, there you have it. He explained real quick what a molten salt reactor is and what it does. The one thing I do have to show you is that these things are safe, that they're not ran at high pressure, but they're ran at atmospheric pressure. So there's no way they can melt down. If the process, you have to keep these things going instead of trying to keep them from going out of control. The reactor is a lot more self-regulating. As far as reprocessing of fuel, that's done chemically separated next to the reactors. You don't need a lot of expensive refuel processing cycles. There's also an advantage to having that spent uranium-232 in the core itself. It means that there's not going to be a lot of weapons proliferation around. It means that you're not going to be able to use that nasty stuff to make an atomic bomb because it fries electronics. It's not proliferation resistant. You can make bombs out of uranium-233, which is exactly what thorium turns into when bombarded by a free neutron. The advantages of a liquid type of reactor are this: complete fuel mixing. Two, you have a complete burn-up of the fuel. And number three, you have a lot less waste than you do with a solid-based reactors we have today. Now, as David said, there are tons and tons of ways of doing nuclear power. We've had some breeder reactors called the integral fast reactor. We've had other type of breeder reactors that are done in a high energy electron spectrum that just we spent millions of dollars just plain don't work. We haven't really tried this one yet, but we did have a successful 5,000 hours of a prototype done at Oak Ridge. All right, Dave.
Dennis.
Dennis, I'm sorry. My apologies, Dennis.
At a point, Dave.
Yeah, well, no, I'm nervous, so. All right.
Okay. Must be nervous, Tim.
Thanks for the second tip.
This is we're not just friends. This is family. Don't be nervous.
Sorry.
This is family night. Two long-term family members of the college. Okay, Dennis gets the second 10-minute segment. Get it, Dennis.
Dennis, go ahead. The title for my debate presentation is Non-Nuclear Energy Pathways to Increase Our Prosperity, Eliminate All Fossil Fuels, and Promote Climate Protection. Part B, carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathways are inevitable and will make our world a much better place to live. The rapid increase in the worldwide use of renewable energy is reflected in the fact that it represented 22% of global power production during 2013, with a total capacity of 1,560 gigawatts, equivalent to 1,560 large 1 gigawatt, 1,000 megawatt nuclear reactors. In fact, throughout the European Union, the share of renewable energy was 72%. By the end of 2013, about 144 countries had renewable energy targets and some sort of renewable energy support policies. We hear again from physicist and energy consultant Amory B. Lovins, co-founder and chief scientist, Rocky Mountain Institute. Quote, on a national scale, as Rocky Mountain Institute and the National Renewable Energy Laboratory have shown, operational and organizational shifts now underway can extend renewables to at least 80 to 90% of total electricity with full reliability and little bulk storage. Indeed, with perhaps less storage and backup than utilities have already installed to manage the intermittence of their giant coal and nuclear power stations. The keys to such high renewables futures are realizing what modern renewables can do, deploying them sensibly, and teaming them with very efficient use of energy, unquote. Quote, doing all these things together and making, by 2050, U.S. electricity 80% renewable, 50% distributed, and highly resilient, has a 14% IRR, unquote. IRR stands for internal rate of return. Rather than being costly, this transition is highly profitable. We can even do better than that. An American carbon-free, nuclear-free energy economy is inevitable and will make our nation a lot better place to live. We can have a 100% U.S. renewable electricity grid without any nuclear power or fossil fuels within 20 to 25 years. The goal of the carbon-free, nuclear-free project at the Institute for Energy and Environmental Research is to eliminate U.S. climate-disrupting pollution from burning fossil fuels by promoting a zero carbon dioxide economy in the U.S. and to lay out a roadmap to achieve this as soon as it's technically and economically practical without resorting to nuclear power. It takes an integrated and comprehensive solution because the problems of human-made climate disruption, nuclear weapons proliferation, and insecurity of oil supplies are interconnected. A carbon-free, nuclear-free energy future is much more likely than a nuclear thorium future. The questions are, how quickly are we going to get there? How much time, talent, and money will be wasted on this nuclear thorium nonsense? How much damage will be done by the nuclear power and fossil fuel industries? However, let's make the wildly hypothetical assumption, as highly improbable as it seems, that we will have a nuclear thorium economy anyway. The hard cold reality is that a 100% nuclear thorium electricity grid will sell less power. First off, the power prices with an all nuclear thorium grid will increase by 5 to 8 times their current rates. As a result, customers will respond by self-generated all or a part of their electricity with combined heat and power or cogeneration, wind turbines, solar photovoltaics, PVs, etc., which are more economical. In turn, utilities will see their revenue shrink and be left with installed asset bases with little way of producing revenue to pay for them. Let's look at the potential of energy-efficient buildings in China. Mark L. Clifford, a journalist and the executive director of the Asia Business Council in Hong Kong, considers, quote, one of the most important elements in the quest for more environmentally friendly Chinese buildings, more sustainable buildings. environmentally friendly Chinese cities more sustainable buildings. There are enormous opportunities for energy efficiency in the building sector because green buildings can dramatically reduce energy use. The Natural Resources Defense Council calculates that in China, green buildings can cut electricity use by 25 to 50%, water use by 40%, and solid waste by 70% compared to a conventional building. Buildings account for more than half of all electricity consumption in China, so cutting electricity use by 25 or 50% would have a significant effect on electrical demand and on the need to build power stations. If all of China's buildings were energy efficient, the annual savings would be enough to provide more than 4 months lighting in the United States. Of course, this is a theoretical and ideal number, but it does give a sense of how much energy could be saved through a transition to more efficient buildings, unquote. Continuing on, within the darker radioactive cloud is the brighter sunshine lining. The ongoing Fukushima nuclear disaster, which started in 2011, was an unintentional jump start for Japan's solar photovoltaic PV industry. Japan now has one of the world's most generous financial incentives for solar PV electricity, more than three times the level in Germany. These are feed-in tariffs. They pay the producers of solar PV electricity a set amount for the power that is sold to the utility grid. Being one of the largest solar producers, Japan had about 7 gigawatts of the world's total installed base of 100 gigawatts of solar PV generating capacity as of 2012. During the fiscal year ending March 2014, Japan installed another 7 gigawatts of solar PV capacity. Being set in 2009, Japan's pre-Fukushima targets called for installed solar PV capacity of 28 gigawatts by 2030 and 53 gigawatts by 2050. However, these targets will probably be exceeded. During 2010, Japan had only 1 gigawatt of installed solar PV capacity. By mid-2014, the Japanese had more than 14 gigawatts. 1 gigawatt is the size of an average large nuclear reactor. The challenge of Japan's utilities handling this newer solar PV electricity opens up the opportunity for the Japanese to make an updated and modernized smart utility grid with advanced storage. All of Japan's 54 nuclear reactors were shut down after Fukushima began, and only two of them have operated intermittently since then. Now let's see what can be done in India to immediately cut black carbon pollution, otherwise called soot or particulates, and improve the well-being of its population. Dirtier cook stoves burning some sort of biomass, wood, dung, field waste, or charcoal, are still being used by about 160 million households throughout India, which is over two-thirds of the population. According to journalist Mira Subramanian, quote, "The impact on the climate and human health caused by the smoky emissions from household fires is devastating. A global health study released in 2014 estimated that household air pollution from cook stoves causes over 4 million premature deaths annually, with more than a quarter of those in India. The smoke from these fires contains dark particles that absorb sunlight and hasten glacial melting, and the soot has contributed to the formation of a brown cloud over South Asia, so expansive that it is visible from outer space," unquote. The ideal solution for improved cleaner cook stoves seems to be electrical induction cook stoves running on decentralized microgrids powered by distributed renewables, smaller scale solar, wind, biogas, and hydro projects. Their use is starting to take off in India. They are incredibly efficient and cost about the same as mid-range improved biomass stoves. If they are run on microgrids powered by renewables, these electrical induction stoves could provide a means for millions to move away from directly burning biomass altogether. Roughly 600 million Indians lack access to electricity. We are going back to India to wrap up this section. China and Taiwan together now account for over 70% of all global solar photovoltaic PV production. According to the Solar Wind Energy Council, the Global Wind Energy Council, China had installed 91.4 gigawatts of wind turbines as of the end of 2013. That is equivalent to 91 large 1 gigawatt or 1,000 megawatt nuclear reactors. The Chinese are going to put $361 billion dollars into renewable electricity generation by 2020. Breaking down to roughly $72 billion each year, this huge effort will create more than 13 million jobs. Solar, wind, hydro, tidal, and geothermal will contribute to about half of all newer electricity generation. We can compare this progressive action by China to the regressive action by the Trump administration to reduce the U.S. Department of Energy's, U.S. DOE's, budget for renewables. I agree with Dr. James Hansen, the world's leading climate scientist, that, quote, the U.S. should double or triple its investment in energy, unquote. But that should be carbon-free, nuclear-free energy technologies rather than nuclear thorium-fueled molten salt reactors. Now, what should be done about China's nuclear thorium project? Begun in 2013, the $350 million, 140 PhD scientists, and 750 staff that the Chinese have wasted on this nuclear thorium nonsense so far should have been completely redirected into their more productive renewable energy generation. Thank you very much. And that's part B.
Excellent. Tim Bolger.
All right. Let's address the installed supposed green Germany economy. What you don't know is that Germany is now buying a lot of its power from France. What does France have? About 90% nuclear. What else has happened in Germany? There's fossil fuel consumption that's gone up because they took down the nuclear power plants. Number three, power is a lot more expensive in Germany under this renewable plan than they've had in the past. Now, I don't know where David's getting some of his things from about 70% capacity, because the last time I looked, renewables only accounted for about 2% of the worldwide power mix, and it's taken quite a long time to do so. Frankly, I'm getting kind of sick of some of these solar and wind advocates indicating that it's going to be an all-renewable, all-glorious world. What happens if you look in the manufacturer of solar panels? This stuff is done in China, and they do use some nasty environmental stuff when they're made. Now, I'm not saying it's not worth pursuing, and certainly not, but you also notice the Chinese have an all-of-the-above strategy. They're not only putting the money in the renewables, they're also taking a look at what we did in Oak Ridge in the 1960s and trying to apply it. What you also may not know is that there has been a large private sector interest in the development of thorium molten salt reactors. Number one, I'm going to talk about Flybe Energy. It's a new company ran by Kirk Sorensen. There's another one called Thorcon out of Canada. And there's about four others that I can get into in just a little later on. One or two of them are within 2 years of developing a molten salt thorium reactor. Now, the big thing I like about thorium molten salt reactors, every wind turbine takes about 12 years of payback before you recover the manufacturing costs in it. Every time you put up a solar or a wind turbine, remember, there's about 10 to 12 years of energy already put into them before they recover their costs. There's about maybe 20 years of useful life before they have to do any kind of replacement. And we're going to have an area the size of Arizona to provide all of our power needs covered by wind and solar. You know, we also talk about the distributed smart grid. That's going to cost about $10 billion. When all we really need are some small, and most of the problems is, yes, this stuff works in India. Yes, solar and wind work out well out of the thing. But if you want an advanced industrial economy with your internet access, with your cities coming in, with all your bright things, you're going to need some highly efficient form of centralized power. It's not going to go away. I mean, if you look at the entire power output of Hoover Dam, it can only power 4 Facebook data centers. They have a lot of renewable power out right now in Washington, D.C. Can it be used in the data centers? Can it be used in industrial advanced processes? No, because the power fluctuates. It needs to be handled. It needs to go into something else. So you're always going to need that backup capacity. I don't know if you guys realize just how much work goes into a smart grid. Yes, it can be done. Yes, it's technically feasible. Maybe about 100 years out for deployment? Yes. What are we going to do in the meantime? Probably burn coal, probably burn oil. I think it is highly outrageous that we have to sit here and eliminate an entire course of fuel. The main reason I like nuclear is this. Take a look at my key fob here. With a thorium molten salt reactor, my entire energy supply in my lifetime could be contained in a modular thorium about this big. And we're going to discount this. These reactors also burn up the existing nuclear stockpile fuels. They can be used to do something. And yes, Dennis has mentioned the uranium-233 stockpile. Those can be used as starter fuels. Now again, we're not burning the thorium. We're burning uranium-233. The thorium is converted to uranium. And then uranium then goes off. You see, the whole key behind the uranium-233 molten salt reactor is, number one, they are a liquid. You can get the thorough mixing of both involved. Second, you can have 100% burn-up of the nuclear fuels, and you can put the waste in there too at the same time and burn up the transuranics that go for thousands of years. You have to sequester this stuff for maybe 400 years for it to become better again. But certainly, with a typical reactor, from what I've heard about, a basketball size of thorium could power the entire north side of the city for a good 5 years or more. We can deal with a basketball size thing of hot thorium for 400 years rather than all the pollutants that are gonna come out with anything else. Personally, I'd like to see us work more together. You know, the nuclear industry, the wind and power industry, not be at each other's throats. I like the all of the above strategy that we're going to need it. And frankly, if you're an environmentalist and haven't really thought about nuclear, I'd like you to go talk to Robert Stone, the guy who did a movie called Pandora's Promise, and talked about how several key environmental people who were very anti-nuke, once they started looking at the data, the science behind it, the other things. Now, I know about Avery Lovins. I know about Helen Caldicott. I know about several of our anti-nuclear people. And as I dug into the research, I found a lot more brashness and more lies on their end. Now, I'm not, and I can get into this a lot later on in the web. What I will say is this. If you don't like nuclear, then our world is going to be burning fossil fuels. Yes, we might have renewables to kind of take off the edge a little bit, but it's still going to be based in an oil-based world. The only real way that you're going to replace oil or any form of fossil fuels on a large scale is through the large-scale deployment of centralized power plants. Things that can, you can build a few modular thorium molten salt reactors on an assembly line, you could truck them in, connect them up to the grid in place, and you'd have your alternative power source. It's not going to be easy. I know that we can probably do it in a lot easier fashion, but as Alvin Weinberg said from Oak Ridge, the developer of this, we're going to have institutions watching this stuff into which we're not accustomed. For me, I like what Richard Martin says. This thorium revolution's inevitably going to happen. Whether we do it, whether the Chinese do it, whether anybody else does it, it's going to happen. The nuclear genie is out of the bottle. It's only there for an investor to take it off, whether it be through Chinese or private American companies. It's inevitable. Thank you. We've had our two parts. Now we'll have our concluding remarks. Dennis, if we're ready to go up. And I'd like to thank you guys for listening and coming tonight, by the way. Okay, Dennis, you said. Okay. 5 minutes now.
Let's distinguish between energy needs and energy requirements. The assumption that we need nuclear thorium in any form to supply our ever-increasingly electrical consumption so that a growing population can live better is fundamentally flawed. Do we really want and need the attempt to save nuclear power with thorium? There is no economic, environmental, or security rationale for the liquid molten salt thorium reactor. There is no need for it, period. An inherently cleaner and safer carbon-free, nuclear-free energy economy is the wave of the future. An inherently dirtier and unsafe nuclear thorium economy is on the wrong side of history. The rock-bottom basis of a carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway is energy use reassessment, least cost energy planning. We should ask these six crucial questions. Number one, how much energy do we really require? What kinds of energy do we require? What do we want to use the energy for? How long do we want to use the energy? What are the costs of using the energy? Economic costs, environmental costs, and social political costs. What are the moral and ethical implications of using the energy? The six crucial questions that I have just posed should be in addition to any no nukes versus pro nukes discussion. They are in addition to directly discussing the specific energy sources and energy technologies that we either be implementing or foregoing. I use the word discussion instead of debate, even though I agree to this debate. There's no real debate over nuclear power. The facts and experiences clearly show that nuclear power is unviable and that nuclear technology is one of our biggest mistakes. But it's even more basic. Nuclear power is simply unnecessary. The negative effects of climate disruption are being seen today. It is too late to stop them entirely. However, if we band together immediately to push for technically and economically feasible carbon-free, nuclear-free energy solutions, the worst impacts can be avoided from runaway, out-of-control climate chaos. But we are running out of time. We can still save and maintain the essential qualities of our life here on planet Earth. What it boils down to is taking the appropriate actions right now in maintaining human existence as we know it. This will require a political, considered effort from the ground up. Stanford University environmental and civil engineer Dr. Mark Z. Jacobson and his colleagues have come up with a plan to make the technically and economically feasible transition in all 50 states to 100% renewable sources, wind, water, and solar, by the year 2050, with an 80 to 85% conversion by 2030. That would provide about 3.9 million 40-year construction jobs and around 20 million 40-year operation jobs for the renewable energy facilities alone, the sum of which would outweigh the 3.9 million jobs lost in the non-renewable energy sector. This conversion would also eliminate about 62,000 U.S. premature deaths due to air pollution each year and around $3.3 trillion per year in 2050 climate disruption costs to the world due to U.S. emissions. According to Dr. Mark Jacobson, in direct response to pro-nuclear climate scientist Dr. James Hansen, the costs of nuclear far outweigh the benefits when compared with wind, water, and solar. We can meet all of our energy requirements with wind, water, and solar. Therefore, we have no reason to subject ourselves to the risks associated with nuclear power. This, quote, the significant time lag between planning and operation of a nuclear power plant relative to a wind, solar, or geothermal plant, unquote, prohibits nuclear from being a useful energy source in the time scale that we need it. Contrary to James Hansen, nuclear should be excluded from the list of renewable sources. Including nuclear power in an effective renewable energy portfolio, as James Hansen erroneously does, is a perversion of how renewable should be defined. Renewable sources, solar, wind, biomass, hydro, ocean thermal, tidal, and geothermal, are constantly replenished by natural processes whether we use them or not. By contrast, nuclear is a non-renewable energy source which was first harnessed at the University of Chicago on December 2, 1942 by a human-made sustained nuclear chain reaction. That was the birth of the nuclear age. With a mountain of radioactive waste going on 75 years high and still growing, we need to end the outmoded, antiquated nuclear age and proceed with the where it's at renewable age. No matter how much or how little rad waste is produced by a nuclear thorium fuel cycle, more of this radiotoxic waste is inevitably going to be generated and will have to be kept out of the environment. Nuclear thorium as a so-called clean, safe, and green energy source? Not on your life. No self-respecting environmentalist or environmental group is buying into the nuclear thorium hype machine. If I have some time left, Michael Schellenberger is one of these so-called pro-nuclear environmentalists, one of these phony balonies. I'll have to go into that in more detail, what he said in the TED Talks. The Chinese have said basically that they would have an operational commercial thorium reactor by the year 2040, Tim, 2040, which is 23 years away, too late to do anything about our climate problem. I'll discuss in more detail later.
Okay.
I refer you to the chart on the page. As of right now, they're saying 10% as of last year is being taken care of by renewables. About 10 to 16% being nuclear power. Now, those renewables, I'm going to acknowledge they have a place. They have a definite impact. Heating buildings, conservation, the smart grid, it's all good technology to get our power consumption down. Who wouldn't want wind, solar, and these types of things? What I'm simply going to say is this. The discount, the nuclear option, is crazy. To discount a source of power that we can really rely on when the sun don't shine, when the wind don't blow, is something that we really need to do. I will tell you and conclude with a story about a guy who helped develop the light water reactor. His name was Alvin Weinberg. He was director of the Oak Ridge National Laboratory for many years, and he was one of the first to acknowledge the problems of the widespread deployment of the light water reactor. Remember, this is a guy who helped invent this thing. He worked with Rickover to get the first submarine reactor. The first reactor at Shippingport was basically a scaled-up version of the submarine reactor. And when he started seeing the hyper-scaled-up versions of this submarine reactor, he started worrying and having problems with the nuclear safety concerns. But instead of sitting there and yapping about it, he did something about it. He tried to come up with a viable alternative. He didn't discredit nuclear because it's unsafe and it's radioactive. Hell, if you go to a geothermal power plant in California, they release more radioactive materials on a daily basis than a nuclear plant ever would, because that radiation is what they call naturally occurring things. But if you compare the amount of stuff they do, like radon and some of the stuff that they bring up from the ground, it's much, much worse than what you'd have in a nuclear power plant. A coal-burning facility, the same time, more radiation, more particulates, more things. Yes, coal should be phased out or useful. Or better yet, pair up the coal with a nuclear power reactor, make a better version of JP5 through coal gasification, where we could burn it much more efficiently, and have our aviation industry through some carbon, what I would call a carbon neutral fuel. Bottom line, Alvin Weinberg tried his best, was one of the first to acknowledge the problems of global warming, of the problems with the existing molten salt reactor, so much so that he was fired by the Nixon administration in 1972, and his molten salt reactors basically shut down. And that's the reason we don't have them today. Fortunately, though, a gentleman by the name of Kirk Sorensen around 2004 started publishing these things. And you know, you can get all this stuff on Oak Ridge online. I'll be more than happy to show you where it's at. The energy from thorium thing. He was the first guy to convert them to a PDF format. And we can see the work they did. So can the Chinese, so can the Russians, so can the Yugoslavians, so can any private country in the world. The other thing that you got to understand about thorium, it doesn't have to be mined. Everything we have, from our smartphones to our electric cars, requires something called rare earths. Rare earths are those metals that your solar panels need. So even if we did go to all the solar panel things, we still have a lot of thorium tailings that we need to take care of. Why not use it for a productive source? As a matter of fact, I could get into this in the question and answer session, but to me, to not pursue nuclear power, especially in a safer, better form, it's crazy. Particularly because now the genie's out of the bottle, and inevitably, as I said with the author Richard Martin out of a book called Superfuel, this thorium revolution is going to happen. Thank you.
Well, boy, yeah, it's going to happen whether you like it or not.
Well, it is, Charlie. I guess if we're ready to take questions, I'm going to take a break for about 2 to 3 minutes. So, Dennis, if you want to take the first couple, I would be more than appreciative of it, please. So we're ready for questions, and I'm going to let Dennis take the first couple, and I'll be right back up.
Wait a minute, a little business thing. We got one or two people that might need a ride to the L. So,
okay.
So if you got a car, please offer to just hit the blue line.
Yeah, we'll make some arrangements tonight. Okay. All right, Dennis, you ready to take some questions?
Yeah.
All right, and I'll be right back in.
Okay.
Dennis, please. Andy, if you're ready to moderate, we're set. Unless you just want to go ahead and call him out.
No, I'm Andy. Moderate. Andy, you want to moderate?
I don't know. Yeah, go ahead, Andy. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Okay, who asked the first question? Okay, Charlie, go ahead.
This clean energy, we need energy in significant volumes. In clean energy, won't you end up with like a 40-watt bulb in your house and the family sitting in one room? It doesn't have any volume capacity.
Is that a question, Charlie?
Yeah, does it have any capacity? That's the issue. We need industry needs electricity at high volume.
So what's your question, Charlie?
Does clean energy able produce in high volume?
Yeah.
Yes. That's what Mark Jacobson and his colleagues have shown. They've said that the world can be converted to renewables. And then did a state-by-state breakdown that shows that they actually have the exact percentages. And if you want to check the website called the Solutions Project, with him and if you heard of actor Mark Ruffalo, that they're like co-involved with this. And yes, it can, combined with energy efficiency and combined with storage techniques. What Jacobson and his colleagues show is that, see, wind and solar are complementary. You have to combine them. And this was independently talked about by Dr. Arjun Markajani, the physicist and engineer that came up with carbon-free, nuclear-free, and also Amory Lovins, who have three high-powered technologists on my side, or our side, the green side, that say that it can be done. You're using ice for storage, using wind turbines to generate it at night. You have batteries, you have flywheels, you have all kinds of storage. And on top of combining solar and wind, then when the sun doesn't shine, at night, the wind blows maybe more, and so you combine the two, and then you have you fill in the gaps with hydropower, and then you have your base as geothermal. And that's what Mark Jacobson and his colleagues have concluded. So yes, that they've concluded, and are actually we're using less energy overall because of efficiency and because of more efficient conversion processes. So the answer to the question is yes, Charlie, it can be done. We just need the political will to get it done.
Yeah.
Yeah, question.
Your opinion, light bulbs in apartment, it's not dangerous, like it's not radiation, it's not light bulb what we use in apartments, or houses, it's not dangerous, like any radiation, any percent of radiation for the health, is dangerous or not?
Well, it depends upon, you're talking about the safety of light bulbs in people's apartments. If it's an older light bulb that contains mercury, I mean, that's a very small percentage of mercury, and the bulb should be disposed of properly. That would could be a concern, and anybody that's going green, come on. No, 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 let me answer the question. Let me answer the question, okay? Because this is important, because I've heard this argument before. Now, the amount of mercury in an incandescent light bulb is very minute in comparison with the mercury released by a coal-fired power plant. And I've been involved with putting pressure on governmental officials, submitting comments and whatnot to reduce the mercury emissions from coal. The mercury and air toxics, unfortunately, that's one of the things that the Trump administration, we have President Donald Dumkoff, who's an ecological ignoramus, who wants to cut back on the US EPA, and that's one of the things that he wants to cut back, and that's the mercury and air toxics rule. There are other light bulbs that are safer. You have the compact fluorescent light bulbs, and particularly the LED lights, light emitting diodes, and the costs for those have been coming down, and the LED light bulbs contain no mercury at all. So it depends upon the type of light bulb, but definitely if you do have something that's older, and you think it has mercury in it, or you know has some mercury, even if it's a small amount, make sure it's disposed of correctly. It could be, should be disposed of actually as a hazardous waste.
Thank you.
Okay.
Raj.
Hello. I have two questions, one for Tim, one for Dennis. When will be first commercial thorium plant will be on? And Dennis,
okay.
When will be 50% of the energy, world energy, what year will be 50% of the
energy
will be renewable.
Raj, from my own understanding, is that there's a company called Thorcon. They're talking about a commercial reactor in about 4 to 5 years. And there's about five others that are also working on different types of the thorium, molten, of the liquid fluoride thorium reactor. They're all predicting commercial feasibility within about 10 years. They've all been funded, at least now, because they're small startups. But once the commercial viability is proven, or even starts to be proven, I'm expecting a lot of investment capital to come in and start showing the world the way to go. We may not need government subsidy on some of this stuff, because once I think it gets into place and we start seeing the smaller modular reactors come in, I think we'll be winding up cheaper on the road. Dennis, your part of your question now.
Well, I just wanted to reiterate what I said a little more detail. Michael Scherenberger, again, was with the Breakthrough Institute, and I talked about this when I talked about the Exelon nuclear bailout. December 17th, the so-called progress groups, organizations, that environmental progress, he went to China with Dr. James Hansen, the climate scientist that we both know about, that I mentioned in my presentation, and they talked with the engineers. And the engineers told him that they would, you're making the big valuable about all this China business, Tim. They said a commercially operational reactor that could be sold in 2040. Of course, Michael Schoenberger goes, oh, we have a climate issue. Can you speed it up? Can you just skip the demonstration and go for commercialization? And the engineer looked at him and said, would you drive a car that hasn't been demonstrated? Duh. I don't drive, but I don't know where I'm going to have to look that up. It's in the TED talks, Tim, the TED, the TED talks, and that's what Scherenberger says, and I've got it right here with you. And I've got it right here with me. It's 2040, and that's what the Chinese are saying.
I can probably...
I didn't ask that question. I asked question is that when 50% of the half of the country will be renewable, what is
it? Pardon?
He's asking when half the world's energy will be powered by renewables. What year, roughly, the time frame for widespread deployment of renewables to get a 50% mix?
We're talking about 100% mix within anywhere to 20 to 40 years. So it'd be like half of that. I mean, the study I told you, it's not 50%, it's 100%. I could look it up during you guys are doing your rebuttals, I can look it up with Mark Jacobson and his colleagues have come up with, but I mentioned the 80% conversion and then by 2030 and 100% for the United States by 2050. When you say 50%, I don't see why you would, no offense to the The question's been, it's kind of, I've already answered the question according to what the findings of the report, but I'll look it up and see if they have a 50% figure, but we're going for 100% here.
Okay, over here.
Yeah, you both did not mention oil at all. Does oil figure into this? I mean, oil costs so much, and there's so many cars. Does it? And it sort of affects what goes on in the housing field. So what do you think? What do you say?
Well, actually, I did mention oil very briefly. I talked about oil insecurity as one of the three interrelated problems that carbon-free, nuclear-free is tackling. On December 17th, I talked about alternatives to oil. So I'm not going to come in here and say the exact same thing every single time. I have new and different material. In fact, I have so much material that I've actually over-prepared, and I probably could do a 45-minute presentation by myself about this. It's interesting that Tim's first videos mentioned all the administration saying that we need to get off oil, and that we've never really done it. And this is not the first time I've seen this. And what carbon-free, nuclear-free does, and also the Solutions Project, is going to be a combination of the two, provides a clear road path for us to do that in the shortest amount of time, but we just need the political will to get it done. But very definitely, oil instability, dollars going overseas being wasted, dollars that could be spent here creating jobs, good old homegrown wind and solar, other than importing oil from overseas, very definitely it is an issue.
Okay, let me make a corollary to that. We're going to be on oil for a while because it still is an efficient power source when you have gasoline compared to wood or compared to others. It still does a lot of our driving, a lot of our power production, and certainly a natural gas plant is going to be a lot better as far as carbon, as far as blowing a lot less carbon into the air than you would with a coal power plant. The thing is, nuclear has zero carbon emissions. The thing is, with the widespread deployment of electric cars, with the widespread deployment of perhaps maybe hydrogen fuel cells, or even the carbon neutral fuels that can be made from other items, meaning that it can pull carbon out of the ocean or out of the atmosphere and be reused to effectively block it, are still going to be around for quite a while. Oil represents a large stake in our energy production. Hell, we're going 2 miles below and 2 miles into the ocean to find it. We're fracking the hell out of our earth right now by blowing it up subterraneanly to find it. It's going to be around for a while. And right now, we have a glut in the United States that probably won't last long, but until we actually get a power source that can competitively beat out oil, which is what I think nuclear is going to do, especially with the when we see production of these molten salt reactors and other forms, I think that's what's going to eventually get us off oil. But it might take 50 years or more to do so. But, and don't forget, I'm not saying that renewables are a bad thing. I am not saying that energy efficiency is a bad thing. All of the above, with nuclear being a large and viable component.
No, we're not going to do that. We're going to respond. I'm going to respond to Tim. This is a debate, and we'll get to as many questions as we can. Tim, your boy was elected to the White House, Donald Trump. And ever since, and I was one of the forewarners of this, at December 17th of last year, and then some rebuttals and talking about what this administration is doing, was going to do, and is doing to turn back environmental progress. You're talking about fossil fuels, and the Trump administration is the one that, they want to get rid of the increased fuel economy standards for cars and light trucks that the Obama administration passed under the Department of Transportation, which I supported, and they want to lease more coal on public lands, which I oppose, and they want to open all the areas of offshore that have been offshore, to offshore oil and gas drilling, which I oppose. So here, you know, you voted for this guy, you can get up with Paul and do, it was kind of a clever presentation, but it was also kind of goofy and silly. Well, what can the Trump administration learn from the Cubs? Maybe they can wave the W flag. Come on, Tim, come on. I'm the one that here has been warning you people about this administration. I'm not the only one out there, and I've been marching in the streets besides, and you're the one who voted for this guy, and this is what he's doing to increase fossil fuel use. The Chinese, on the other hand, want to reduce their fossil fuel use. That's why they're going ahead with building nuclear reactors, bad idea. They're going ahead with thorium research and development, bad idea. They're going ahead with the renewables that I've mentioned, and the priorities for the Chinese are very clear. You're talking about $361 billion, BB billion dollars, as opposed to the amount that I stated, and you know, that goes into the thorium program. Another thing, nukes are not carbon-free indirectly. It is a scientific fact that the nuclear fission process produces not an atom of carbon, and I addressed this on December 17th, but the whole process, the whole what's called the whole nuclear fuel cycle is very carbon intensive. From the mining and milling of uranium, the transportation, the fabrication of the fuel rods, the enrichment of the fuel in particularly is very electricity intensive, the radioactive waste disposal, the decommissioning. And these are things that need to be factored, and studies have shown that considering these things, the climate disruption pollution from nuclear is greater than that from solar, wind, hydro efficiency.
Over here.
Tim said that solar and wind makes up about 2% of the power.
No, I'm sorry, I correct myself.
Okay,
in the chart.
Okay, I'm getting to that. And that chart is about 10%, right?
Right.
Okay. But you come up with these fake facts of 60% and all these other...
There's a lot. If you go in to Dave's study on some of the stuff produced by the Rocky Mountain Institute, you're going to find that these people are saying exactly what he says. You're going to find that the claims made by these guys, particularly Helen Caldicott, particularly Avery Lovins, particularly other people, are what I consider a bunch of bunk. What I'm going to tell you is that go in, look at Gordon MacDonald and what he does in his videos. What I've talked to a lot of people about these types of issues. It's much like what we're seeing. Millions of people are being affected by the radiation from Fukushima. Yet we haven't heard about, maybe aside from a couple of workers, no real deaths. Let's go back to Chernobyl. You're talking about all the hundreds of people that are going to be affected by cancer and radiation. Like it or not, there's people back now living in that area, around things. Look at the studies, the original studies from the UN and the other people that come in. There has not been a real death by nuclear power. It's the safest industry in the world. What it simply has is what we call a black swan problem. It's, you guys are so worried about the mushroom cloud, the clouds of radiation. When you go up to like the higher altitudes or to some of the other areas, I encourage all of you to watch that movie, Pandora's Promise. You go with a Geiger counter, you go in some areas of the world, you'll get to it and you'll see 2.5 times background. You'll see radiation going all the time. You will see that what the claims that are made by certain anti-nuclear people are bunk.
Yeah.
I can show you on the web, maybe at some other point, that some of the facts and figures that have been proved, quote unquote proven, are not true. And if you want to see it, I'll be more than happy to show you some of the sources at the end of our rebuttals. Yeah.
Up here. Tim, you mentioned that you seem to think that thorium can be obtained from without recourse to new mining.
That's correct.
One of my concerns is that the it's just the fact that thorium is a byproduct of coal mining and
yes.
sort of husband and wife technologies, and the demand for thorium will add value to coal mining and thus perpetuate the coal regime, because it's going to drive down the cost, you know, the unit cost of producing coal. It will lower the cost because you've now added value to it, because you're producing a byproduct that has a high value. So even though you would like to see the thorium come from other sources, my suspicion is that, you know, due to economics, it will in fact increase coal, and where it will cut back on is the renewables. But rather than encouraging renewables, it will actually diminish renewables and increase coal. I mean, that's my concern, just based on economics.
Look at that government stockpile that David has mentioned already.
Dennis.
Sorry.
You're hosting.
No, I know I'm hosting.
He's hosting Toastmasters?
I have a friend of mine whose name David that I will call it the, I apologize, Dave.
One of the D's.
Dennis. If you look at a particular mine called the Lemley Pass in, I think it's California, where they mine rare earths right now, there's enough thorium in there to power our country for at least 5 years if we went to 100% modular thorium molten salt reactors.
Yeah.
There are tailings that are just considered waste product right now that we could use. The mining that will take place will not be for the thorium, but it'll be for the metals that are mixed in with the thorium, the rare earths, the stuff that makes your solar panels, your electric cars, your other things. The only place you can obtain it right now is China, because right now thorium is classified as a nuclear material. It is radioactive, but it's got the half-life of the universe. You could basically hold in your hand some thorium and not have ill effects. You would if you did it over a 2-3 year time period, because it is a radioactive thing. But with the proper safeguards, you know, a little bit of containment, a little bit of something, this stuff is safe. Now, the dangerous part, when the uranium-233 is burned up with the gamma rays in the plant itself, that's what's going to have to be sequestered for 400 years. The fringe benefit of all this is that you get something out called medical isotopes. There's a shortage of them right now to fight cancer, to do other things. And right now, the only way they're made is in certain reactors in Canada and China. Their half-lives are short, but they are very good for detecting cancer and other things. What you really need to do with the mining is that you don't have to mine thorium. It's so plentiful that we can almost get it out of sand. A block about this type of earth would have enough thorium in it to maybe power your own life for about a year.
Okay, let's give our speakers a hand. We'll go to rebuttal now. Let's have a show of hands.
I want to respond. We're not going to do rebuttals quite yet. We're going to a couple minutes here, okay? The gentleman talked, I don't know what the 60% figure I heard. I never said that. I'm talking about the increases of renewable energy worldwide. And the statistics I have are from 2013, and I have more recent, where the amount of renewables contributing to the world's economy is increasing every year. So I don't know where this figure, I've never said 60, or I heard a 60, 50, I accused me of saying
what
60%.
I heard you say 80%, 60%.
I'm talking about what we can do.
What you can.
What we can do in the future.
He's saying 10%.
Well, that's where I don't agree, see? And that's the issues of programs and policies.
You don't give a figure.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I wanted to get into the thorium business. Tim seems to think that being around thorium is a walk in the park. And I have here some health and safety aspects of thorium production. This is an excerpt from a United States Atomic Energy book published on thorium in the late 1950s.
So don't eat thorium, don't breathe thorium, just put it in the reactor and make energy. No, leave it in the environment, go carbon-free, nuclear-free. But thorium is radiotoxic when it's inhaled or ingested into the body. For example, if the thorium enters the body, the thorium-like substances tend to settle in the liver, kidney, spleen, lymph nodes, and bone marrow. And so we're talking about the thorium radionucleotide. So this stuff about thorium being harmless, it's not, because the radionucleotides, well, that's what you're referring to, and that's what you're implying, and this is what, if it's ingested internally, the radionucleotides that I've talked about can cause serious damage. Plus, there have been deaths from the nuclear power industry, from cancer and uranium mining, for example. And Tim's mentioned small modular reactors, and they've been touted as the next best thing to save nuclear power. But the cost for these proposed small modular reactors are expected to be much higher than those for commercially available wind and solar systems of the same capacity. And I'm going to maybe go into this a little bit in my final statement, because I did read everything I gave out to you, but there's some more stuff about why small modular reactors are bad. So let's get on to the rebuttals, okay?
Dennis, I'm gonna stamp
my name on my forehead. I'm gonna take a piece of tape and put it on my forehead next time, Tim, so you'll remember what my name is.
Okay, give our speakers a hand, and let me have a show of hands. Keep your hands up.
It's okay, Tom.
One in the back, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Charlie's nine. I'm 10. Okay, everybody will get 4 minutes. Okay? I will give the first one.
No. They're making up to you.
Before anybody leaves. Excuse me. Okay. We'll take 4 minutes for rebuttals tonight.
They got alternative facts.
Is the speaker still on back there? Can you all hear me? Okay, a few quick points. Harvey Wasserman published a book called Solartopia in 2007. They estimated with just going with the technology of 2007, the United States could be oil-free, coal-free, nuclear-free by 2030. With just the technology and the cost available in 2007. Since that time, solar energy has dropped about 60-70% in price. Wind power has dropped by half. Talking about the cost of thorium versus renewables or solar and wind, you have a factor 10 by 10 by 10. If you want energy for the future, you can get 10 times more energy from renewables than you can from any thorium production. You can get that 10 times more energy for 1/10 of the cost per kilowatt of thorium. And you can get 10 times more energy in 1/10 of the time it takes to build a thorium-based economy. So nobody in their right mind anywhere in the world is talking about advocating a thorium economy. It's a myth. And it's promoted by the same kind of religious fanatics that would tell us that you can be an Amway distributor and a multi-billionaire if you just build your own business. These are religious beliefs that have no basis in reality. We are bathed today, 10,000 times more light falls on us than what we use. People talk about how much energy you need. Take a look at this. This is a new light bulb. It uses 15% of the old light bulbs. A quarter of the nationwide energy is used up in light, all kinds of lighting. We can drop that lighting bill with efficiency and renewables and things like this one. This is what's called a task light. That's an LED. That one will give you the same light on your work area for 5% as much as the old lights. You can drop your consumption needs by 95%. Houses and buildings without heating systems are being built now from Canada to the equator. Glass and insulation will replace the need to burn any kind of fossil fuel to keep a structure warm.
Houses in Schaumburg have been built since 1979 with no furnace. They heat for $10 a month with tiny, tiny heating systems. They have proper walls and windows.
Got your dinner.
50% mix. The criticism of Helen Caldicott, Amory Lovins, and the others, who have been anti-nuclear for years and pro-efficiency, the criticism of these people amounts to outright slander. These are some of the most highly credible people in the world that have been dedicating their lives to trying to help us get away from the nuclear disaster. And to promote a new generation of any kind of nuclear power plants. Hello, people. Can I take a break here for a minute? Sorry. In order to promote a new generation of nuclear power plants, you have to have the same kind of mindset as the people that used to say, well, other than that, Mrs. Kennedy, how was your trip to Dallas? Other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how did you like to play? You know, other than that one small disaster, how did you like the benefits of everything else? To promote nuclear power, you have to be able to ignore the elephant in the room that is just, it makes the whole thing physically, emotionally, environmentally, intellectually, financially toxic. Yeah. Like a huge toxic disaster. And promoting new nuclear power of any kind is 10 to 20 times more expensive than the current generation of solar, wind, and renewables. That's where we are today, and the world is going renewable, and renewable solar and wind power very, very fast. Thank you.
My name is Raj Patel. The thorium technological problems and regulatory problems are so severe that commercial viability is very, very difficult. Financing, security, safety, all those hurdles will take long time. And probably Norway is conducting a project that will give results in a couple of years and we'll know what is happening. On the other side, renewables technology is still developing and other big hurdle is there. What happens when 100 square miles of solar panels gets outdated? What happens to those? And then some of the manufacturing technique involves toxic chemicals, and that is also a question. So lots of development has to take place. Second thing is that we are competing with natural coal, natural gas, and these renewables and nuclear energy. And it's like right now natural gas is so cheap, so it puts the additional pressure on renewables as well as nuclear. Okay, coal technology can change tomorrow and we may be able to get a clean coal, clean burning coal, and it can change. So I don't think we are going to decide what is going to happen. I know nuclear is not going to happen because it hasn't happened in the last 20 or 30 years, and there are lots of opposition to that. But who is going to decide is that business people who have the money and who has the confidence. Technological people who can say that, hey, this technology works. Okay? And the regulatory people, government, decide that they want to invest the money. They want to put the money on this project or that project. If all these things cannot combine, it's very difficult for any project to take place or any technology, new technology to come ahead. And what is going to have is, when you look at our government, when you look at our business climate, when you look at technology, these things are very, very difficult, very challenging, and it's not going to be easy. Thank you.
I'm Dan Vader. I want to give a few thoughts on the debate. I want to thank Dennis and Tim for conducting a good debate. But some thoughts I had, one of them was, if you know, in a way, we're on the Titanic and we're kind of arguing about the deck chairs, you know, that kind of situation. And another thing that came to mind is, you know, the thought experiment. If I offer somebody $10 million for themselves and their wonderful family to come in on a business deal, and I tell you there's going to be some environmental damage, some people are going to become unemployed, do you want to come in? And by the way, there's 10,000 people lined up behind you who'll be happy to take the opportunity. That is the mindset, I believe, of many of the people who have responsibility for making decisions that affect everybody. Second thing, my understanding is that Fukushima is leaking 300 to 350 tons of radioactive water into the Pacific Ocean every day. That sounds to me like an awful lot. There's also claims being made that the Pacific Ocean is gradually becoming a dead zone. And there's a lot of implications that spin off of that. And I think that's something that, again, you don't really see it debated, you don't see it argued, you don't really see much to see. You know, there'll be something in the news periodically. You know, they sent some robots down there to try to plug the leak, but it was too hot for the, you know, for the robots. So that's a second thing. And then the third thing, which I bring up all the time, hate to beat the dead horse, but we do apparently have the average global warming temperature taking on an exponential function. And so, and you know, people can argue about the exact numbers, whether, you know, the one I think is reliable is around March 2015, we had a 0.85 centigrade increase over the baseline, which is usually taken to be 1750, the start of the Industrial Revolution. So, 0.85. Apparently at this point in time, which is, you know, maybe 2 years or so later, we have it at around 1.5. That seems like a huge leap. And, you know, sometimes when people are talking about an exponential function, they start to ask themselves, what's the doubling time? And I think that's a really important issue, and people should be able to, while you still can, because to get access to the data, you can still get it over the internet. There's a number of places to go to look at it. I recommend the Arctic News, but there's other places, because the Trump administration apparently is looking to remove access to the data. And, you know, the mindset of these individuals is pretty much, you know what? We got to do business. We have to have energy. We've got a global population of, you know, 7.5 billion. We have, what do we have, 320 million in the United States. We've got to provide energy for people. And we can't have the economy go down, or that's going to be a disaster. And we'll just have to wait and see. It's the best we can do. But I do think everybody should get educated about particularly the rapid rise in the average global warming. A lot of it is caused by positive feedback loops, such as the tundra in Siberia is melting, the seabed in the Arctic Ocean is melting, and the methane hydrates, or clathrates as they're called, it's being released into the atmosphere. It's happening at a very rapid pace. So time may be kind of short unless something is done. People need to get anxious about it and to press for some action to pull the greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere. It's at that point. Thank you very much.
All right. Another meeting. This guy is falling.
Good evening.
when I was a young boy and they drilled for oil, it was a hit or miss proposition. Today, when they drill for oil, they always strike oil. And the reason for that is a thing called horizontal drilling. They drill down so far, and then they go in every direction. So they always hit oil. What's more, every time they drill for oil, they also do this thing called fracking. Now, there's been a lot of talk about it ruining our water, but the fact is that water is to be found 300 to 500 feet, I think, below the surface of the earth. And when they do fracking, they go down something like 5 to 8,000 feet below the earth. So when they do fracking, they always discover gas. And that's why gas has been going down in price, and that's why that oil is going down in price. And it will continue to go down. Anyone who says we've got enough oil to last us until 2030 or another 50 years is actually very mistaken. We will have enough oil and natural gas to last for at least the next 200 years. We will still have an abundance of oil and gas when we don't even need it anymore. And the time will come when we won't need it anymore, because there will be electric and other alternative forms of energy. But every time we come up with some new concept like fracking or horizontal drilling or whatever, the left always takes a stand against it. Anything that is good for the United States, the left takes a stand against it. And that is an ongoing thing, and facts will bear me out. So I say that whether it's thorium molten salt, or whether it's renewable wind, solar, and so forth. And by the way, wind and solar are basically the same thing, because wind is created by the sun. So the fact is that it really doesn't matter, because my attitude is to let them all compete for their place in the market. And one guy may have a little shack in the Ozarks, and he can get by with a couple of solar panels. And another guy may have a factory that is 5 blocks by 5 blocks that needs a tremendous amount of electricity, and he would need to lean on nuclear or whatever. So let them all compete in the marketplace against each other, and they'll all find their niche. The fact is that we have a lot of jibber jabber going on about the dangers and about this and about that and the other thing. And if we just leave them to compete in the marketplace, everything will work out just fine. Thank you very much.
Bravo, bravo.
Thank you.
This is Alon.
It's on.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm Jan Bodart. I'm from the Nuclear Energy Information Service, and the gentleman who just spoke, I think that's a good idea. But the Illinois State Legislature last December voted $2.3 billion for nuclear power plants that can't compete, and gave them a bailout because they couldn't compete. So when you say let them all compete, you're being just like Pollyanna, because that's not what's happening. They have a lot of money, they buy the legislators, and they mess up the bill so that no aspect of the bill is evaluated on its own merits. And they say, okay, I'll give you so much for solar if you will give us $2.3 billion bailout. And if you don't give us the $2.3 billion bailout, I'm going to block your renewable energy. And that's what happened in Illinois. And so when you say if they would just compete, that would be, everything would be okay. Well, that's just not how it works. I think that one of the things that we that we've been discussing tonight is that solar and wind can't compete because they sometimes the wind doesn't blow and the sun doesn't shine. So what this person is saying is that, well, we're producing several tons of nuclear, high-level nuclear waste that is extremely dangerous. It is 1 million times more radioactive than the fuel that goes into the nuclear power plant. And we're producing several thousand tons of it every year. And we can deal with that, but we can't figure out how to save electricity when the wind isn't blowing and the sun isn't shining. And I think that's just crazy, because we have not been able to figure out what to do with that tremendous amount of waste. We cannot deal with it, and the scientists have not figured out what to do about it. And yet we're saying, oh, well, we can't save electricity because we don't know how. And so I would dispute that. I think we're going to figure out how to save it. And small modular reactors. Number one, they're not small. They take up a lot of space, and they're going to, and they are projected to be underground, so that if anything goes wrong with one of them, what are you going to do? And they use 25% more water than per kilowatt hour, than 25% more water per kilowatt hour than a regular nuclear power plant. Not, believe me, I'm not recommending a regular nuclear power plant, but to say that small modular reactors would be any better is not so. And another thing about sodium-cooled reactors is, you know, Rickover wouldn't have anything to do with them, mainly because if you get sodium wet, it explodes. I was in a chemistry class and I saw this. It was really cool. And you know, this little piece of sodium was running around on top of the water until it disappeared, and it was zipping around and producing this enormous amount of energy. So the chemical reactions of sodium are very, very dangerous. There's enough water in the air to set them off. A tiny leak in the cooling apparatus means sodium is going to leak. And sodium is going to leak, and it has a tremendous reaction with H2O.
All right. All right. All right. Who wants to hear my Sean Spicer?
Mo.
Elizabeth Hardy.
All right, I got warm. I pulled out my bowling shirt. Bombs over everything. Pull that out tonight. Anyway, Dennis, you probably know this answer. How many active coal-fired plants in Illinois? How many active nuclear plants in Illinois? Roundabout.
14 reactors.
14 nukes. How many coal-fired? How many?
Eight
nukes in Illinois now? Active?
No, I think it's 14.
How many coal fired? 110 now?
Nobody knows.
I'll have to look that up. I thought you guys were.
Why didn't you look it up?
Why don't you look it up? People like you need to know this. This is stuff we need to know.
Well,
We're not here for your information. I'll put you on Spicer on you, Charlie. All right. Anyway, every month I get reports on shipments of coal, shipments of oil, shipments of nuclear material, shipments of everything. I know more than 12. Anyway, so.
But you didn't know how many reactors.
Well, I'll have to look it up. I thought I came here for the being learned, you know,
I get all
learn something.
Information.
What do you expect from a Sox fan?
You didn't know. Sox fans say, man, we did it first. Anyway, the charts show, I don't know why we're worried about nuclear and coal, because coal shipments every month go down, 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 down. Coal is a dying, dead industry. The renewables, wind and solar, are coming on so strong. Natural gas is replacing coal. And I don't even know why we're worried about it. There's so many different ways to get electricity these days. There's going to be solar panels on everybody's roofs eventually. Yeah, we don't need nukes. The problem we're going to have, you global climate changers, is oil. It always has been oil. Get on the oil train, because oil and jet fuel and gasoline keep going up and up and up every year, every month. So the biggest polluter in the state of Illinois is O'Hare Airport and Midway Airport. That's the they release carcinogens, soot. There's kids dying of asthma. Air pollution is terrible in Chicago. So talk all you want about climate change and all the different things like that with global warming, but air polluters like Boeing and United and American and commercial aviation are the real problem. Oil's the problem. We go to war for oil, we go to war with oil. Thank you.
Just like Trump.
Thank you to Dennis, not Dave, and Tim.
I'm going to not live that one down for a while.
Have a piece of cake.
Thank you to Don, and Dennis this evening. Inevitably, a lot of these great debates that we have at the College of Complexes bring me to three dilemmas that we can't work out without a lot of outside the box thinking. How do we get full employment with a living wage and health care? How do we all live to be 1,000 years old in good health? And how do we find more planets? That's really what you guys are debating this evening. These are not easy topics to debate, but there are some things that we got to keep in mind. One thing, I did bring some flyers in the back today of Washington Square, where they have the Bughouse Square debates. The only regret for this evening is I wish you guys could have debated this at Washington Square outside. Other than that, I thought it was a pretty interesting, lively, respectful conversation about how to live and coexist with our planet. Slim Brundage once asked, can people govern themselves? I don't think it's an engineering problem, it's a moral problem. People have got to live together in peace and amity. A lot of times in capitalist nations, when the challenge of climate change is talked about, countries that have defunded math and science for decades, at least on corporate airwaves, and I know a lot of you have been rejecting the corporate airwaves and going on the community airwaves, which is smart, because Scott Pruitt, our EPA head, is going to make sure that you have an unprecedented amount of propaganda and misinformation the next, I don't know how much time, until we oust them. But the questions asked on corporate areas, how can energy be marketed to generate profit for the goal of power? See, we start off with the wrong dialogue because the wrong questions are asked on corporate airways. The questions should be asked is, how can sustainability be reached to care for people for the goal of survival and equality and democracy? We shouldn't be asking the questions, how can energy be marketed to generate profit? That's we're starting off on the wrong foot altogether. It's like saying, how do we have a better military? How do we have more bases on Earth? We're already starting off with a non-starter, so then the conversation turns into difficult to reach solutions. This is a brief poem that I wrote on this topic a long time ago, and I'm still trying to find the answer, so I commend both our speakers this evening for searching for the answer, because it's not easy. Earth ain't our garbage can. Earth's not a dumpster. We are living beings, not cave dwellers. Earth ain't a punching bag. Earth ain't a dartboard. If we don't know it yet, that's what our hearts are for. Earth ain't a guinea pig. Earth's not a test site. It's a place to live. Our very best is required. Earth ain't a junkyard. Earth ain't a shooting range. We are on a block of stars who call for system change. Two books I would highly recommend is the David Suzuki Reader, A Lifetime Ideas from a Leading Climate Change Activist and Thinker, and of course, Naomi Klein, This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. Keep on talking about new ideas to make our planet be able to survive this 21st century, you complexity collegians. Happy Earth Day.
All right.
Oh, so everybody, well, I can't say everybody left, but many people left. My name is Margaret Aguilar, and I've been affiliated with NEIS for many, many years. And we went to see Michael Schellenberger, who has a, or Schellenberg, I don't even remember now, who has a dog and pony show about how nuclear energy is going to save us. And he is the person who is responsible for Pandora's Box, which was basically a smear and slander and libel campaign against Amy Lovins and Helen Caldicott, and at which I really, well, at any rate, he called on me because he didn't know who I was to ask a question, and instead I made a statement and I refuted his claims that nuclear energy is really safe, and a number of things like that. And so we got into this back and forth thing, and I said, you know, why did you build, or well, why did he build, why did the nuclear industry go willy-nilly and build nuclear power plants in unsafe places? Like in Diablo Canyon in California, they built a nuclear power plant there on top of an earthquake fault. And he said, oh, everybody in California builds on earthquake faults. My home is on an earthquake fault. And I'm thinking to myself, that answers all of our questions. He's crazy. Okay.
Good evening, dear friends of Slim Brundage. Seekers of the truth, one and all, and finders of a new facet of truth, now and then, here and there, in this or that statement or event to improve the quality of life. We have come here to learn something so we could improve the quality of life. And coming on the bus here, I found this here bottle. It was rolling around, I'm gonna recycle it. From the creamers, I'm taking these here and I'm going to recycle these from the creamers. And also I'd like to tell you, go to by Wendy's restaurant. This Dave Thomas, who founded Wendy's, he was in an orphanage. And he has, over the years, he has gotten 5,000 out of the orphanage. Go by Wendy's. You get a free coffee anytime if you're over 55. At McDonald's and Burger King, you have to pay 55 or 65 cents, and it's 2 ounces less than by Wendy's, so I'm trying to promote Wendy's. My cousin Patty, she was born the same day, December 2nd of 42, when they, at the University of Chicago, under a tennis court, they had that nuclear explosion or whatever. Okay. I ran across your statement here. Eat it up, wear it out, make it do, do it out. Eat it up, wear it out, make it do, do it out. Waste not, want not. Eat it up, wear it out, make it do, do it out. Waste not, want not. I thank you.
Charlie, you got one?
Yeah. Charlie. Okay, so you talked about free coffee at Wendy's. All right, let's thank both our speakers. Be eclectic, as usual here. I came across an article today that said some things you could do on Earth Day. Three things you can do on Earth Day. And actually, one of them, the other two weren't very poignant. But the third one caught my mind. It was said we could avoid leakage, which is probably true, by taking care of the leakage or waste of the energy that we're already producing. We probably could do well to instead of these schemes pursuing these venues. By making better use of the energy that we are producing, in essence, which is true. Some of you guys missed the best points. This is a debate. You're supposed to pick up on what the other guy says and use it against it. Now, Dennis, I'm sorry, this guy said, and you said it there, and you didn't pick up on it, and he said that renewable energy doesn't produce enough energy to power, in essence, I'll make it better, the internet, Facebook or Google. That catches speed in someone's mind. If renewables can't even generate enough power for the internet, they've got a ways to go. Now, conversely, this guy also informed me, that thorium nuclear reactors produce basketball, I guess they're radioactive basketballs of waste matter. I guess they're like glowing basketballs that remain glowing for 400 years. Now, how many of those do they produce? And what the hell do we do with them? If you have a radioactive basketball that glows in the dark, bright red. Now the other thing is, if all of you are so energy conscious, why did you leave this thing glowing for another an hour without turning it off? Yeah. Nobody in the room but me saw that. Anyhow, the other thing is, the problem with radio, yeah, and he hit on it too, this radioactivity, man. I mean, what are you talking about? What are you trying to minimize? Chernobyl? There was a radioactive cloud that went over Europe?
It made
Europe radioactive at Chernobyl, and the other one, Fukushima. The map is floating around, it just came across, it made the entire Pacific Ocean radioactive. How big a span of the Earth that is? And he's minimalizing this. You and your pals say, oh, that's nothing to worry about. You only made the ocean radioactive. What do you think? This is just I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. What is this, a little mistake like at work? I'm sorry, pal. You made half the Earth, a good significant portion of the Earth, uninhabitable. And you can say, well, I'm sorry. Or, it's not that bad. Anyhow, I got one more. And the last thing is, I love this about thorium. Thorium doesn't exist, so you can make up stuff. Make up all you want, since it doesn't exist. You can make it, it's all appropriate.
It's all fiction.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll see you guys next year.
Speaker's got the last word.
I'll go first,
you guys.
I'll go first, Dennis.
Dennis will get the last word.
Yeah.
I think it is absolutely amazing. You know, I've made some pretty fantastic, or perhaps some of you may consider, preposterous claims tonight.
No, I think that of you.
I just have to tell you that most of the people involved in the Thorium movement I've met personally.
Oh.
The author, Richard Martin, I met at the Thorium Energy Alliance conference a few years ago and had a chance to talk to him about his book for over 45 minutes. And I was impressed with his depth of knowledge, his suitability to answer my questions, amongst which many Dennis had. I also met another guy by the name of Richard Hargraves, who wrote a book called Thorium, Cheaper Than Coal. I sat next to him at another conference, and we had a good hour-long conversation about why thorium in the molten salt reactor is going to revolutionize the world. One of the principal videographers who does a lot of the Thorium Energy Alliance conferences is a gentleman by the name of Gordon McDowell, who, yes, I've also met in person and had a chance to talk to for a good hour or more on why he's involved in this stuff. And, of course, many of you have already met John Kutch, who's presented here before, the president of the Thorium Energy Alliance. I do not come to my views on nuclear power out of having a screw loose. I come to them because I really think that it's going to be a viable tool that is technologically possible to save the planet. I invite any one of you to check out the claims. Go to the websites. Watch Gordon McDowell's videos on Helen Caldicott and Avery Lovins and some of the other people. And even if you don't agree, I myself have just learned a lot more about the solar and wind industries in the last 3 or 4 weeks. And there are some incredible things happening. I'm acknowledging some of Andy Anderson's and Dennis's claims as to this stuff getting a little cheaper. But it's still gonna be a big scaling up. There's not, right now, we don't really have a way to store electricity except maybe in the form of hydroelectric power or something like that to get it at a certain thing on demand. I will close with this. If you doubt what I have to say, check out the Thorium Energy Alliance homepage. Go up there to resources. You're going to find a heck of a lot of nuclear stuff that will basically, if you look at it rationally and reasonably, I think you will find that I've made some rational and specific choices. We could go on and on tonight endlessly about Pro and Andy Nuke, but I also have to remember, I'm gonna correct you, you're talking about the light water reactor, the sodium reactor. They're completely different animals than the liquid fluoride molten salt reactor. But it's also different than the fast breeder reactors. If you look on Google as well, Google Kirk Sorensen. He did a 3-hour long talk at a place in Canada about 5 years ago. And he goes into some pretty good technical depth on a lot of these issues. To summarize, please check the facts. Please test my claims and take a good, long, hard look at this question. It's always better to ask questions and draw your own conclusions. Thank you.
Look up Fukushima while you're at it.
It's a poorly designed
look at
reactor.
Fukushima.
I have.
UK, SHIMA.
Go ahead. Thanks, everybody, for a very spirited discussion. I appreciate the comments. We live in nuclear Illinois. We have more nuclear reactors than any other state, so just screaming and shouting from the audience. We have 14 total, 3 shut down, Dresden 1, Zion 1 and 2, with 11 reactors operating. Tim mentioned pump hydro storage, which is another form of renewable energy storage, so thank you. We are going to need federal subsidies and ratepayers' money to pay for any new nuclear reactors. Now, by analyzing 6,000 source materials on the Chernobyl disaster, the late Alexei Yablokov, the grandfather of Russian ecology and environmentalism, concluded that 985,000 premature human deaths resulted from Chernobyl. And another thing to point out is that the cost of Chernobyl and Fukushima, along with Three Mile Island, is upwards of $170 billion in combined property or human health damages. In 1952, President Harry S. Truman's Paley Commission favored solar over nuclear, but we made the wrong choice. When Eisenhower's Arms for Peace program came in, that was swept away and we went nuclear, and now we have the chance to make the decision right to go carbon-free, nuclear-free. It's ridiculous to say that a geothermal plant releases more radioactivity than a nuke because geothermal plants produce no high-level radioactive waste. The movie Pandora's Promise has been mentioned by Tim, which is a piece of pro-nuclear claptrap, and we leafleted, NEIS members leafleted outside. Nobody who calls themselves an environmentalist should be pro-nuke. Both Michael Schellenberger and Stuart Brand should be ashamed of themselves. And they both make the technical inaccuracies in the TED talks and the TED debates in saying that no foreign country had a nuclear power program before nuclear weapons. Horse crap. Both Pakistan and India used their nuclear power programs to produce nuclear weapons. Amory Lovins was correct in 1976 when he said that the main driving force behind nuclear weapons, the proliferation, is commercial nuclear power. The land requirements for wind and solar are smaller than what a lot of people realize. We have a lot of existing commercial and residential roof space, over parking lots, in parking lots, over highways, areas that are unused near airports to put solar PV panels. And for wind, a lot of the areas can be used for both ranching and farming. And the ranchers and farmers can get a double income from having their cattle and agricultural crops and also getting money from the wind turbines. 2 to 4 years payback, energy payback for a solar photovoltaic system. Oh, concerning Germany's energy transformation that Tim mentioned, in Germany, the accelerated deployment of solar photovoltaics significantly reduced peak electricity prices by over 50% from 2007 to 2011. Now, Germany is aiming for 100% renewables by the year 2050. And there are things that they have, the feed-in tariff program, just like Japan. In fact, the Germans had it first. Things that Germany could have done better was to look at, for example, enhancing storage and transmission capacity. I guess my time's up. Thank you very much. Until next time, happy Earth Day and no nukes.
Okay, thank you all for coming, and we are adjourned.
What happened, Alan? Thank you.